has so many different stories in it. It has so many different things that Jesus did in it. And it's very interesting. And I would like for all of you to read it. Not today, not right now. But when you go home, just read the whole 10th chapter and get where the lesson is coming from today. So before we get started, we'll begin by reading our verses. Verse 46. And they came to Jericho, and as he went out of Jericho with his disciples, and a great number of people blind, Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, sat by the highway side begging. 47.
Said unto him, Go thy way, thy faith hath made thee whole, and immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus in the way.
Our key verse together. Jesus answered and said unto him, What will thou that I should do unto thee? The blind man said unto him, Lord, that I might receive my sight. Mark 10. As you see, our text this morning is very short. Very little short story, but it's a lot in that story. But I want to go back to the beginning at the 10th chapter. And we'll talk a little bit about that, and we go from there. Mark, the 10th chapter, is, as you notice, whenever you read in the gospel, it's always a multitude following Jesus. He always has a crowd following him. Why? Why is every time you see Jesus in a great number of people or a great multitude? Why?
Because he got things done.
Now what?
He got things done. People knew that they could rely on him to do the things that they were expecting. I mean, he had already gained a reputation by this time for being the person that could heal the sick, raise the dead, give sight to the blind, turn water into wine. So he had a great popularity because of the works that God was doing through him.
Anybody else?
Miracle worker? One of the
His reputation, that's the word. His reputation went before him. You know, right now, and y'all can remember when we used to have the tents, and they would say, Oh, Brother Milligan, preaching over there. Boy, he doing some healing. Boy, this. He had a can and dropped the can at you. You know, his reputation went before him. Like you said, the people heard about what he was doing. And when they heard that Jesus is coming to town, everybody wants to go see Jesus. Right now, if T.G. Jakes come to town, everybody wants to go see him. So his reputation went before him. And in verse 1 through 12 of the 10th chapter, Pharisees are trying to trap Jesus, tempt him, and talking about know that story. He brought the children to Jesus, and the disciples didn't like it. But he said, no, don't do that. Bring them to me and let me bless them. Because if you don't accept the kingdom of heaven as a little child, y'all know when y'all give a child something, the child accepts it. Right or wrong, because mom and daddy is saying, or they used to be like that, mom and daddy are saying, or grandmama is saying, or adult is saying, so they accept. But Jesus said, hey, if you don't accept it as a little child would accept things, you can't enter in. And from 17 to 22, chapter, verses, this is the 10th chapter, the young ruler came to Jesus and he said, Lord, what must I do to be saved? Jesus told him what he had to do. He said, well, all these things you're telling me I've done already. Jesus said, one thing you lack, go sell what you have and give to the poor. And he was hurt. Why was he hurt? And in the world to come, eternal life. told Peter, said, if you left all these things for the gospel's sake, in this life, you shall receive 100-fold. So what he's saying, you left all these things and forsake all these things to follow Christ in the gospel. But don't be dismayed. You're going to receive something for it. You're going to receive 100-fold in this time. But then, even better than this time, you shall receive eternal life.
Right.
So you're going to receive eternal life in the world to come. So follow Christ. Follow the gospel. Do what the scripture tells you to do. And in this life, God is going to take care of you. But in eternal life, you'll have life eternal with Christ. Jesus and his disciples went on to Jerusalem, and he was telling them what was going to happen to him, how he was going to be delivered to the chief priests, and he was going to be beaten and killed and mocked and all of these things. So he wanted them to know before they got there what was going to happen to him. And the sons of Zebedee, James and John, went to Jesus and asked. They wanted Jesus to do something for them. They were his disciples. They said, Lord, when we get to heaven, can I sit on the right? Can my brother sit on the left? And can you see? What do you see in that? What? Selfishness. I won't sit on the right, but I want my sister to sit on the left when we get in heaven. I want to be right next to you when we get into heaven. And you know what Jesus said? That's not for me to give. But it's prepared for those that are prepared for it. Now, how did they know? Jesus said, can you drink of the cup that I drink of? Can you go through what I went through? Can you be baptized with the baptism that I have been baptized with? And they thought they could. But Jesus said, you can't do it. 39 said, and he said unto them, we can. And Jesus said unto them, ye shall indeed drink of the cup that I drink of. So they were going to die. After Jesus leave, they are going to experience some things that they don't want to experience. And with the baptism that I am baptized with, ye shall be baptized. But to sit on the right side and the left side is not mine to give. But it is given to them for whom it is prepared. If you're ready to sit on the right hand, and if you're ready to sit on the left hand, and if you're worthy to sit on the right and the left, you will sit there. But that's God's place to give. God is going to give that. And I don't think none of us is worthy to sit on the right and the left hand side of Jesus when we get to heaven. If I get there, I'm fine. I'm going to sit by you, Jesus. I know you're there. So if I get there, I don't have to sit on the right or the left-hand side of you. Okay, from 41 to 46, where our lesson begins today. And the disciples, after they heard James and John, what they asked for, they were very much displeased. They were very much displeased. But like somebody said, that was selfish. That was selfish. And it says in verse 42, you know that riches are accounted to rule over the Gentiles, exercise lordship over them, and the great one exercise authority upon them. But so shall it be among you. But whosoever will be great among you shall be your minister. And whosoever of you will be the chief shall be servant of all. For even the Son of God came not to be ministered unto, but to minister and to give life as a ransom. So ransom for anyone. They were plain men and women like me and you, and God called them to be there with his disciples. So it wasn't their place to ask that. So now our lesson begins at 46. Now after Jesus left Jerusalem and was coming to Jericho, great number of people followed him. There's always a great number of people around Jesus. And there was this man named Bartimaeus. He was blind. I don't know if he was blind from birth or what, but he was blind. And he sat by the highway begging. That's all he did. Every day he went out by the highway and begged. He was blind. In the ancient days, blindness was very familiar. It was a familiar disease because it wasn't really a cure for it. We know now there's a cure for some eye disease. Some, it just, it's not a cure. Macular degeneration, your eyesight just gets weaker and weaker as you get older. The cataracts grow. And did y'all know that everybody born with a cataract on the eye? Did y'all know that?
Everybody's born with one.
Everybody is born with cataracts on their eye. But as you grow, older, the cataract grows too. So it's mostly like as you get a certain age, then your eyes start getting dim, then you have to go and have the cataracts taken off. Uh-huh. But there's eye drops you can use now. But back then, the Egyptians made a potion. And what they would do, they would take a bird feather and paint your eye, paint over your eye. And sometimes it would help. So they would say that would help, but it didn't really heal. But there are many people that are blind because of some disease, or some are born blind. But there are many people that have eyes wide open, big like mine, and are physically and spiritually blind. They're walking around every day doing whatever they want, but they're spiritually blind because they know the gospel. They haven't accepted Jesus in their lives, so they are spiritually blind. Yeah. But Bartimaeus, he sat by the road every day begging. And how he got there, I'm assuming that someone would take him to sit by the wayside and he would beg all day long. A blind man could not work.
No.
You can't work if you can't see, right?
That's right.
A blind man could not be a priest. If you're a priest, you can't do the work of God. So his job was to survive. He depended on his family or what he begged for or support from friends. And it says that when he heard that Jesus of Nazareth, he cried out and said, "Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy upon me." A crowd of people following Jesus. Blind Bartimaeus sitting by the way. What's going on? Why Jesus coming by? Jesus. Yeah, Jesus of Nazareth. What Cicely said before, his reputation had already gone up. You know Jesus healed this man, woman, blind son? You know Jesus went over there and a guy was lame and couldn't walk and Jesus healed him? Jesus healed somebody that had a demonic spirit? All of this. So what does it tell us? You have to have something about Jesus. You have to know something about Jesus. Because anybody, I can come and say, you know, Jesus, well, the first thing you say, well, who's Jesus? If you don't know him.
Right.
But then if you know him and I come and say, you know, Jesus coming by, Jesus, you understand about this man. You know about this man. And he began to cry. Can you imagine? I already heard that he healed somebody that was blind. Can you imagine? Jesus of Nazareth, thou son of David. Now, he went a little further. That goes to show you he knew that Jesus was in the lineage of David. He knew something about Jesus, and he knew something about the son of David. He knew that Jesus was a descendant of David, and this Jesus that's going by is healing and making people better, and everybody, oh, Jesus, you know, you just can imagine, you know, a crowd of people following you all the time, and you want to know what the noise is about. I can't see it, but I want to know what the noise is about. And they say, Jesus is coming back. Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. 49. And Jesus stood still.
Yeah.
It was something about his cry. Y'all remember the woman with the issue of blood?
Yeah.
She believed that the crowd was heavy. But she believed, oh Lord, if I can just get to him. I can just, he ain't got to touch me. He ain't got to say nothing to me. I can just get to him. And when she passed through the crowd, and I believe sometimes she might have been on her knee crawling trying, but she got close enough. If I can just touch it, touch his garment. And when she touched it, Jesus felt the virtue going out of him into her. Jesus said, who touched me? The disciples look around. All of you in, you ask, who touched you? Who touched you? Everybody been touching you. He's no. This is a different touch. This touch is not like the touch of I'm just coming and touch you. So when Jesus heard him, Jesus stood still and commanded him, hey, and command him to be called. And I guess the people that was around him said,
Jesus first. He called out to Jesus first to get Jesus' attention.
Yes, he did. But did Jesus have to say, bring him. Bring him to me.
No.
Jesus didn't tell anyone to bring him to. Jesus told him to come. And because one of the imperatives was for him to rise. And that was important. And we've seen that before too. Where when Jesus told the man to take up his bed and walk, he had to get up off of the station that he was in order to even approach Jesus. Jesus didn't come to him while he was still sitting on the ground. He had to rise and go to Jesus.
Okay. Jesus calls us to do a lot of things. A call, we all get a call. Obviously, we all get a call, but we have to do something. Mm-hmm. Jesus could have said, over and said, yeah, your faith has made me whole. But Jesus wanted him to do something.
Yeah.
He wants us to do something. Like Cicely said in your book, 49B, I'm sorry, I don't think it wasn't his book. 49B, he had to get up.
Right.
He had to get up. And his friend said, be of good comfort, he called you. And what does 50 say? And he cast away his garment, rose, and came to Jesus. Now, he's blind now, y'all. He know Jesus is in the way. But he, whatever he had on, I guess that probably would have been all he had. He threw it away. Wow. Jesus of Nazareth called me, and he got up. And he went to where Jesus was. And Jesus answered and said unto him, what do you want me to do for you? What is it that I can do for you? And what did he say? Blind man said, Lord, that I might receive my sight. Now, how many senses we have?
Five
senses. What are they?
Hearing.
Sight is one.
Mm-hmm.
Smelling is one. Taste is the other. Feeling and hearing, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's it. Out of all of these, if the Lord would say right now, you got to give up one. Which one would you give up?
That's a good one.
Which one would you give up? And I'm saying this now, but I lay it out with you in my mind. Take away the tears, and then I make a noose of wind. But Lord, I want to see. The first thing you want to say, Lord, whatever you do, let me see.
Yeah, number one.
Everybody want to see.
Yeah.
Because I got to hear you coming, but if I see you coming, I still can run.
Uh-huh.
I know I'm going to get hungry. I ain't got to taste the food, but I can eat it. It's time to eat, so cookie, you go ahead and eat some.
Like it.
But I can't see. Like my eyeglass, I was sweating, my eyeglass keep doing this, but I got to see what I'm looking at. So blind Bartimaeus said, Lord, that I may receive my sight.
And I think that in making him get up out of that station that he was in is where he began that process of becoming fully whole and becoming and being able to see. Because Jesus asked him specifically, tell me, what do you want? He was out there with a beggar's cup. Everybody knew what he wanted. He wanted some spare change. But what he really wanted was his sight restored, or to be able to see, period.
And verse, thank you, ma'am. And verse 32, he said, and Jesus said unto him, go thy way, thy faith hath made thee whole. Now, did Jesus make him whole?
Faith.
His faith in Jesus made him whole. We all have a measure of faith. But what do we have faith in? Do we have faith in God, or do we have faith in ourselves? I believe if I can't see it. One time I thought it was something I couldn't see, it wasn't there. This big old world, and I'm just a speck in this world, but if I couldn't see it, it wasn't there. But your faith is what saves you. You go and ask Jesus for something, and Jesus, I need this, but then that's the end of that. You don't have no faith in yourself, and you don't have no faith in Jesus. But this man believed that if Jesus can heal someone else, Jesus can heal me. And it's the same with us. What Jesus does for someone else, he can do the same thing for you. But do you have that kind of faith? Do you have the faith that blind Bartimaeus had? Now, there was another healing when Jesus healed the, but that's the end of our verses. No. Yeah. It was another healing in Mark 5, 18 and 20 when Jesus healed a man that was possessed. And after Jesus, verse 52 said, and immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus in the way. After he got his sight, he was so happy to see, I'm going to follow this man. I'm going to stick right with him just like he will. In other words, he joined the multitude of people that was around Jesus. I'm going to follow this man. Wherever he go, I'm going to follow Jesus. He gave me back my sight. There was another healing of the demonic man, and he wanted to follow Jesus, but Jesus told him, no, don't follow me. Go home. Go and tell what happened to you. When God does something for us, He wants us to share it with somebody else. Don't keep it to yourself. Mm-hmm. You don't know who you can help saying. Just like he heard about Jesus, it probably was people talking, you know, he couldn't see. You know what? They say Jesus did this, and they say Jesus did that. Jesus wants us to share it. Don't keep it to yourself. When God does something for you, don't keep it to yourself. Tell somebody else. Mm-hmm. And you know, people might get sick of seeing, oh, here come her again, here comes her again, that Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. But they bring what they want to you, and you stand there and listen.
Uh-huh.
So why not you carry what you know or what God has done for you, carry it to somebody else? Blind Bartimaeus, he followed Jesus. I'm going to follow Jesus. I'm going to go wherever he goes. Whatever he commands me to do, I'm going to follow Jesus because he gave me my sight. I can see. And there was another healing of the blind when Jesus healed someone that was blind and he put sand in his eyes, spit and put sand in his eyes. And he told him to go wash it up. And when he went and wash it up, and they asked him what he sees, he said, I see a man look like a tree walking around. Mm-hmm. But Jesus could have healed him the same way, but what did Jesus do? He put the thing on his eye. He had to go wash it up. Don't say, I'm a child of God, and you don't do nothing. You will just sit and do nothing. When you become a child of God, you are going to do something. Everybody ain't going to do the same job. Uh-uh. Everybody ain't going to sing on the choir. Everybody ain't going to usher up, and I always use the usher in the choir. Usher up and down here. Everybody ain't going to pick up the offering. But you want to do something. But he tells us, he commands us. First thing we got to do is love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, all thy soul, all thy mind. Love Christ with everything you got. Like last Sunday when we ever danced down the street. He danced with everything he had, everything, all of his strength, all of his energy. That's our first thing you got to do. And what the second thing is you got to do?
Love
your neighbor as yourself. And if you're not going to hurt yourself, why would I want to hurt you?
Right.
If I love me, I should love you. And now y'all, sometimes that ain't easy to do.
Uh-huh.
It ain't easy to love everybody. But God knows. That, what is that saying? As much, and y'all, I like the quote scripture, and you know where you come from.
Uh-huh.
As much as lie in you, live peaceable with all men. Y'all hear that before? God knew when he made us that it was going to be some, that was going to be hard head, stiff neck, broad shoulder all the time. And sometimes it's not easy to love people like that. But he wants us to love people. And when you can't, this is what my mom used to say, if you can't stand it, we're still in it.
That's right.
If I know Ms. Boone is this terrible person that, Ms. Boone, if you're in the front seat, honey, you can pick at. I know she's a terrible person and she just all the time. I ain't going to be around her. I stay out of her way. That doesn't mean that I hate her, but I'm going to stay out of her way because she has ways that I don't like or ways that would make me feel bad, or it may be weird that it make me say something I ain't supposed to say.
Yeah.
So what you do, mama say, if you can't, if you don't like the way, stay out the way, go on that way there, if they over here. So that's what you do. But that doesn't mean that you hate them. You should love them. And that's what God commands us to do. Any question, any comment about our lesson? Somebody ask a question, somebody can comment. You know, when I was going to school, I ain't never been smart. The teacher could tell whether to study or not.
Yeah, right.
You know that?
Right. Yeah, everybody.
They could tell whether you study or not because nobody says nothing.
Mm-hmm.
So, but I love y'all anyway. Still love y'all. But I can say this now. Y'all got your book. Everybody got a book. And please, y'all, read your lesson. Just end. Go back and read that 10th chapter of Mark. It has a lot of things in it that is very interesting. Okay, let's read our prayer for today. Father, reveal to us our blindness so that we might be spiritually whole. As you extend that mercy to us, may we do likewise to others. Open our eyes, Lord, and let us see you clearly so that we may follow. Sunday school that is sick. Continue to pray for them. We have bereavement in our Sunday school. Bereavement. Go ahead. Before I say something, I shouldn't say.
Oh, yeah.
Anybody here bereavement anywhere?
Line that I thought in our lesson was profound, and before we get to the conclusion, it says, eventually, each of us will reach the point where there's no healing of our bodies, but are we moving daily towards the holiness that Jesus offers? I think that's a great question at the point of time.
Yes, every day we should be. Did y'all read this little story, Faithful and Dead? It talks about this man, he was a hospice worker.
Right.
And he was amazed at some of the people that when they were dying, how they react. They were dying, but they were calm, and they talked about the Lord, and they knew the Lord.
Right.
And I think that what he's saying is a difference when somebody is dying that know the Lord and somebody that don't know the Lord. There's a calmness, even though you're pain, you're wrapped up in pain. You know there's going to come a time and there's not going to be any healing for the physical body.
Yeah.
Time is up. Time for you to go. Mm-hmm. But your attitude in doing your death. I've heard, you know, some people, you got to fight them and all like that.
Yeah.
Some people just lay there calmly singing or humming. But they say eventually each of us will reach the point where there is no healing for our current body. But are we moving daily toward wholeness that Jesus offers us? When you wrap up in the arm of Jesus, I believe you're dying will not be hurt. I never died, also. Your dying will be a much easier experience. So let's work every day. Every day let us work toward, because y'all know now, one day, everybody know that, and a lot of people don't like to hear this, but one day, all of us is going to be laid up. All of us. We remember great grandma. Where great grandma at now?
Gone.
In the grave. Where grandma at? In the grave. Where mama at? In the grave. One day, all of us will be laid up. So now start working now. Start working right now toward that wholeness that school, those that might be sick. I don't see Miss Sadie this morning, so keep her in your prayers. She's always here. There's a lot that, comes and we don't see them. So just when you kneel, or you don't have to kneel, just pray for the Sunday school, pray for the church. Keep our pastor in your prayers.